All right, I'm Mark Hefner. I live in South County, St. Louis. I'm the other senator. I have 9 children, 6 sons and 3 daughters. I have 7 grandchildren. And when I found out that through birth certificates and social security cards that I had unknowingly made corporate slaves out of my children, I was a really unhappy person, okay? We showed the signature line on the checks, and that is called microprinting. And now, if I started a corporation, and I knew that I had started a corporation, I would open a corporate checking account for that corporation that I would be the president of, and it would make some sense for the signature line to say authorized signature, because the corporation I would start wouldn't have a hand and couldn't sign anything. It would take a flesh and blood human being, the person who had started the corporation. But on a personal check, it doesn't make any sense, because on a personal check, it's a personal check. But the truth is it's an all caps name. The checking account that you have is an all caps name. Look at your driver's license, it's an all caps name. Voter registration, credit cards, everything that you do is in all caps. They have created a corporation out of you, and on the checks, in order for it to be valid, the authorized signature of that corporate account needs to sign it. What do you know about fine print? When they put fine print on a document, the finer the print, the more important it is to them, and the more they don't want you asking any questions about. I have run into almost nobody that knew that that signature was on there unless they were part of some type of a patriot movement. And it's hidden in plain sight because it has MP right behind it, which stands for microprinting. But nobody seems to catch this because it's hidden in plain sight. So the corporate identity thing is basically like me sneaking into your room when you're a baby, or sneaking in with your mother at the hospital when you were born, and basically stealing your identity and creating a corporation that you're actually the owner of, okay, but you don't even know that it exists. And then the initial public offering of that corporate entity is offered through a birth certificate bond. You can get as many copies, certified copies of your birth certificate as you want, but you can't get the original.
Why can't you?
The reason you can't get the original is because it was sold on the Securities Exchange as an initial public offering. I was born in the mid-50s, and the initial public offering of my birth certificate bond was sold on the Securities Exchange for about $600,000 in 1955. I have a 2-year-old. The initial public offering of a 2-year-old these days is about $2 million. It really is identity theft. All of these original security bonds, okay, that accrue value as they're used in commerce, and the value of the bonds go up, are actually held in each of the Federal Reserves all around the country. Now, a bond yields its profit to the person who is in possession of it when it matures. Guess when your birth certificate bond matures? When you die. And when you die, the person who, or the corporation that's holding the bond, will keep all the profit that that bond has generated. At my age, with the amount of commerce that I've done and the business that I have run, it's an estimate that I've probably got between $5 and $10 million is the actual value of my current bond. But because I'm not in possession of it, and I'm not even supposed to know that it exists, all those assets based on my identity have done me no good whatsoever. So how did we get into this mess? When we were being formed as colonies, it took a lot of money to get all the supplies and ships and everything over here to form the 13 colonies. British bankers and the British crown put up a lot of dough. Well, they were happy to put up the dough because as long as they owned the colonies, they knew that the resources of this over here would pay them back a very good return on their investment. But when we broke away from them, now they had no return on their investment, and they had a legitimate claim of debt against us. If we weren't going to be theirs anymore, we needed to repay them for what they had invested to get the colony started. It was a legitimate debt that we owed when we were formed. There are sentences in the Constitution that read that the debts under the Confederacy are continued under this Constitution. So the Constitution is also an agreement of debt to the British and to the French, because we asked the French to help us defeat the British, and they wanted to be paid back for their military expenditures. So we basically were broke when we became a country, and what we didn't know, or I didn't know, is that the bank note when other countries loan to a country is a 70-year note. So the 70-year note comes due when Lincoln is president. They don't have the money under Lincoln to pay off the note, so Lincoln doesn't want to give the public lands of the 13 colonies and the public lands of the Louisiana Purchase back to the Europeans in a foreclosure. He'd rather have that not happen on his watch. So he says to the European bankers, can we renegotiate the loan? And they said, well, we might do that, but we're going to want some upfront money. We're going to want better terms, and we're going to want more collateral. Under Lincoln, there were now 34 republics, many of which were not, you know, part of the original 13, weren't part of the Louisiana Purchase. And he went to them because what the European bankers wanted was they wanted the public lands of all 34 republics to be held as collateral against the new national debt for the next 70 years. Well, when the southern states heard that they were being asked to do this in a war that they hadn't fought in for collateral to bankers, and they didn't like the terms, they basically said they're not going to do it, and they seceded. The real reason for the Civil War and the secession of the states was over the collateralizing of the public lands of those republics. Slavery might have been an issue and various other things. State rights was involved in it, but it was really over the collateralizing of the public lands, and they weren't going to do it. Now Lincoln has a problem. He no longer has a quorum to convene Congress. He can't renegotiate the loan because he has no power to pass any laws. So he had an idea, and I think it was the best idea he could come up with because he was in a pretty bad spot. He started a corporation, the Act of 1871, which basically gave him the ability to form an all uppercase United States of America corporation with a physical jurisdiction of the District of Columbia, which was where they had the authority to do business. And he reconvened Congress as a corporation. As a reconvened corporation, he was able to renegotiate the debt, fight the war, and get the southern states to sign under duress, because some of the governors, even after the war, with threat of military action against the state capitals, had their governors forcibly replaced. Once that was done and all the collateral was in for the European bankers, I think Lincoln probably intended to shut the corporation back down, is my guess. But he was killed before he could do it because they realized that this was a sweet opportunity to get around the Constitution. All right, so 70 years go by, and now we're up to the time of the Great Depression. We're up to the time when the rich elite go to Jekyll Island and they look for a way to permanently get a central bank into the American economy. If you have a central bank, the bankers who control the currency make a fortune off of the resources of the people. There have been several failed attempts at having a permanent central bank in the American history, and they'd always been rooted out and defeated after a short period of time. So this time they wanted to make it a little bit more permanent. So I think in 1912 they agreed that they'd fire it up in 20 years later, which would have been 1932. They also understood that if they were going to pull this thing off, what had defeated it in the past was people's knowledge of it being unconstitutional. So they somehow were going to have to control the people. So the same people that put together the concept of Federal Reserve Bank also looked at how many newspapers they would have to buy to control the minds and the knowledge of the people. They determined that they needed to buy 21 newspapers and change the editors into their editors, who would only print things in those newspapers that would cover up what was really being done to the people. So they have controlled. So we have not had a free press in the United States, going all the way back to when newspapers really was the press, all the way back to about 1912. These same people, when radio kicked in, bought the radio stations. The same people have bought the television stations and the satellite and the cable stations. The knowledge that we are sharing here today has been spread abroad to at least 30 million Americans because of the internet. They haven't been able to control the internet like they have the newspapers, the television, and the radio since 1912. So the ability for us to go all around the state and all around the country and find people that are aware of these deceptions is because of the internet. So the internet is bringing down the corporation. Now, so in 1929, they crashed the economy. 28, they redistribute the wealth back. They take away the gold by making us enemy combatants, and they give us worthless Federal Reserve notes for our gold, made it illegal to own gold, bullion. They wanted additional collateral for the next 70-year term. They already had all the public lands. What do they want this time? They want the private lands. So they never put it to a vote to the American people that, hey, we don't want to be foreclosed on. So would you all mind having your private lands, houses, and farms put up as collateral against the national debt so we can spend foolishly for another 70 years and make ourselves rich as politicians at the expense and the risk of your private property? They never asked us that. They just did it. Okay? So by 1933, they had collateralized our sweat equity through birth certificates and made commercial entities out of us and stolen our identity. They had also put our private property up for collateral against the European debt. Some very, very brave people from 33 to 38 took the government to court for fraud, for doing these things. These court cases went all the way to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court ruled that what the corporation had done to the American people was fraud. It was fraud for two basic reasons. There wasn't full disclosure. If I can prove that your grandpa made a deal with my grandpa and that he didn't fully disclose the terms, there is no statute of limitations on fraud. Also, it was fraudulent because there wasn't consideration 2 days. Will you wash my car every day and wax it once a week, and in exchange for that, I will give you nothing? Contract? No contract. There's no consideration going both ways. If I say I'll give you a penny a week and you agree to it, now we have a binding contract. It's a really sweet deal for me, but it's still consideration both ways. So the Supreme Court told the government that they had put our private lands at risk if they defaulted on the loan, and that there had not been full disclosure, and there was no consideration to us for using our identities to be the backing of all the money and to put up our private property for collateral against others, that we had been given nothing in exchange for all that risk. So there had to be full disclosure.